This video is sponsored by Squarespace. If you follow astronomy news, you'll see reporting on things like the chemical makeup of an atmosphere of an exoplanet that's many light years away from us. And so we've obviously never been to that exoplanet to directly take measurements of its atmosphere. So how can we know anything about it? Well, it turns out by splitting light into its component colors, we can deduce a lot of information about that light. Astronomers use this technique to study the makeup and temperature of individual stars, but it can also be applied to anything that interacts with light, like the atmosphere of an exoplanet or an interstellar comet. This method of breaking up the light into its component colors is called spectroscopy, and capturing and analyzing spectra is one of the main ways that professional astronomers study the universe and know a lot more about it and how it works. And for us amateurs, there are now some very good products available for amateur spectroscopy. Both the physical accessories that I'm showing here needed to turn your telescope into a spectrograph, and the software to analyze those spectra once you've captured them. So in this video, I'm going to review these two products and give you a sense of how they work and what kinds of spectroscopy they excel at. My name is Nico Carver, and this is Nebula Focus. To start off, let me disclose that the Star Analyzer 100 and the RSpec software was sent to me for review by Field Tested Systems, and the SHG 700 with guide attachment and a mono camera for it were sent to me by ML Astro for review. I've been in communication with the owners of these two companies, who are Tom Field and Min Trong, respectively, for advice on using their products, and they have been incredibly helpful and have told me that they help customers like this all the time. But they have no say in what I share in this video. Lastly, I want to say that I have no science background, so if I get anything wrong in this video and you have a correction, please do share your expertise in the comments, because I, of course, try my best to research these things and provide factual information, but mistakes can creep in. So I want to start by showing some examples of what these devices are capable of, and I think by talking through these examples, you'll get an understanding of how spectroscopy works and why you'd perhaps want to try it yourself. So let's start with the easiest, most basic thing you can try in spectroscopy. I tried it on three different nights with three different optics just to make sure I really had it down, which is capturing and analyzing a spectrum of the star Vega, which is a nice bright star. When you take a photo of Vega, or even if you just look at it through binoculars or a telescope, you're going to see that it looks slightly blue. And if we were to photograph it with a set of RGB filters, red, green, blue, and then take those three channels and measure the star in each color and plot the intensities on a graph with the intensity on the y-axis and color measured by wavelength and angstroms on the x-axis, we could get a graph like this. But if we want to take this kind of analysis a big step further, that's where we need spectroscopy. With spectroscopy, we can actually capture all the visible colors and their intensities for a much more accurate, detailed graph. So what you're seeing on screen here is a single image taken with my stock DSLR and a Rokinon 135mm lens with the Star Analyzer 100 diffraction grating screwed onto the front. In the world of spectroscopy, this is a low resolution spectrum, but it's still plenty detailed enough that after some simple calibrations in the RSpec software, we get this plot, which tells us a very interesting story. These dips in intensity are called absorption lines. And in the case of a star like Vega, which is an A-type star, the Hydrogen-Balmer series of absorption lines is very clear. With just this simple setup, I've clearly captured the hydrogen alpha, beta, and gamma spectral series, which are the electron transitions of the hydrogen atoms as the electrons jump from one energy level to another. Now, I'm not gonna get too much into the weeds, don't worry, but I will suggest some books at the end of the video for those that want to really dive into the details here. On a basic level though, as this all relates to astronomy, we could say that stars can be organized into stellar classes, which tells us something about their color and their surface temperature and their point in their life cycle and a bunch more. And by looking at a calibrated spectrum of a star, we can tell what stellar class the star is based on the shape of the plot and the absorption lines. Okay. Other than individual stars, other objects that can be interesting to look at with just a diffraction grating are bright, compact planetary nebulae. Here I took a picture with a ZWO color astronomy camera and a refractor telescope and the diffraction grating of the Little Dumbbell Nebula M76, and the result really makes it clear why narrowband filters work so well on emission nebulae like this one. As you can see, when we break apart the colors of the planetary nebula with a low resolution spectrograph, the nebula is clearly emitting light at 6,562 angstroms and 5,007 angstroms. And most deep sky astrophotographers probably know these better as 656 nanometers and 500 nanometers. And these are the emission lines associated with hydrogen alpha and doubly ionized oxygen, which are, of course, the emission lines that are most associated with emission nebulae, because they shine in those very specific spectral lines. Okay, so the approach of just adding the diffraction grating to your existing imaging rig and analyzing the results with RSpec works well for mostly stars, as the name star analyzer suggests, but as a nebula lover, I did get a kick out of seeing the results on planetary nebulae as well. But for objects like the sun, the planets, galaxies, and diffuse nebulae, it can help to use a spectrograph with a slit, which is a slightly more complicated device, but the things that it can do are really neat. And let me start with the primary use case for this one, as it's being advertised, which is using it on the sun. When you use this device, the SHG700, on the sun, instead of a spectrograph, you might call it a spectroheliograph. That's what the SHG means. The SHG700 is a refinement of an idea by Christian Buhl and Valerie Deneux called the Sol-X, which is the original 3D printed version of this. And as I said before, the main difference in this approach compared to slitless is, of course, the introduction of a slit. And what the slit does is, instead of capturing light from the whole field of the telescope through the diffraction grating, we limit the light down to a very small slice. And then, through changing the angle of the diffraction grating inside this housing, we determine which part of the spectrum we want a very high resolution capture of. So it can capture a very small part of the spectrum in high resolution, but it can't capture the whole visible light spectrum at once like the star analyzer can, unless you change out the grating to one with a coarser spacing. The Star Analyzer 100 has 100 lines per millimeter, and the one that comes with the SHG700 has 2400 lines per millimeter. And so when we capture the sun with this device, you can target different spectral lines by rotating the grating using this nice dial here. Here I'm targeting the hydrogen alpha line, and when it's pointed at the sun, it looks like this with sharp cap. Once you have it in focus, which you can find tutorials on, the procedure recommended is then to scan the full surface of the sun by slewing your mount while capturing high frame rate video. The creator of the SHG700, Min, has many tutorials about how to do all the different steps on his YouTube channel, so I won't repeat them here. He even has a handy script for sharp cap that will take control of your mount and scan the sun several times automatically, so you don't have to do it every time. After you've captured your scan or scans of the sun, Min suggests Cedric Champeau's free software JSOLX for reconstructing the full solar disk image from the spectral slit scans, which results in really amazing images that rival capturing the sun with a dedicated HA solar scope. So this is obviously a very impressive achievement that people like Min, Cedric, Christian, Valerie, and others have made possible. It amazes me that a complete amateur to this stuff like me is able to capture these full disk solar images at many different wavelengths and study what is going on with our own star. And thanks to the device and the software and instructions available, it's really not hard if you have a bit of experience with telescopes and you already own the right gear to add the SHG700 onto. I also want to point out that to turn the spectroheliograph into a regular spectrograph for nighttime use requires a guide camera attachment and a second guide camera that also has small pixels. Min does sell this attachment if you're interested, and it's very easy to attach. I haven't had time to get mine fully working yet, but if I do a follow-up video, I'll go more into it and what you can do with it. Okay, now I want to cover who I think these two different approaches are for and what the limitations and strengths are of each approach. The star analyzer can work with pretty much any telescope and camera. For very bright stars like Vega, you can also put it in front of a camera lens, but I found that a bit limiting. It's possible I just needed more practice with it, but I do think overall the better approach to get the most out of it is to use the star analyzer like we would an astronomical filter and put it in a filter wheel or directly on a nose piece attachment on the camera and then use it with a telescope. And a telescope's typically going to have a bigger aperture and capture more light than a camera lens. The RSpec software is designed to be fun and you can analyze your results really pretty quickly, even live if you want to. After a little practice, I could get to a calibrated graph in just a few minutes. So if you have a Windows laptop or a mini PC that you can attach to a bigger monitor, it would be a great option for outreach, as it's really pretty simple to feed the images from your connected camera in, you know, connected to the PC right into RSpec and then see the spectra and use different visual aids built into the software to talk about what you're showing. So I think as an educational tool to get into spectroscopy, RSpec and the star analyzer are well worth it. I also wanted to point something out related to ease of use that wasn't obvious to me until I actually tried it. Even with the diffraction grating installed inside the telescope, I could still plate solve. I tried this with various software, including the popular ASIR, and the reason plate solving still works is some of the light from the stars goes straight through the grating. This is called the zero order. And then some of the light, of course, is split off on both sides of the star into the spectra, and there's first order spectra and then second order spectra. So due to these zero order stars, I could still go to anything in the sky very easily without having to remove the grating. It was still finding hundreds of stars at 700 millimeter focal length. As far as the limitations of this approach, I think the main one is resolution. Whether you get the star analyzer 100 or 200 will always be limited to fairly low resolution spectra. And the SHG 700 is a bigger upfront cost. The device is selling for $880. And then you also ideally need a mono small pixel camera if you don't already own one. So we're looking at about three times the cost of the star analyzer 100 with RSpec software. But I think most people who get the SHG 700 will be getting it for a particular purpose, which is those reconstructed HA images of the sun, which is something that the star analyzer can't do. And while I think solar imaging is of course really cool and it works really well with this device, I'll admit that I'm more of a night owl, so I'm really interested in getting this guide attachment working so that I can do high resolution nighttime spectroscopy with the SHG 700. In terms of limitations, it's fairly heavy, so you need a fairly robust focuser. I found most imaging refractors coming out today, though, do have good solid rack and pinion focusers. So if you're putting it on a modern Apo telescope refractor, I wouldn't worry about it. I use the SHG most frequently with the Ascar 71F, which is not a particularly expensive refractor. It goes for about $650. Okay, another cost consideration is that you want a telescope mount that will slew very smoothly if you want to avoid jagged edges in the reconstructed solar disk images. So I tested mostly on my Astrophysics Mach 2 mount, which is in my observatory, which is a very expensive mount, but I also tested on the ZWO AM5, and both worked well. But it is something to think about because, you know, I wouldn't recommend the SHG 700 on something like the Star Adventure GTI, for example. You want a fairly robust mount to get the most out of this. And, you know, we usually don't pay much attention to how smoothly a telescope mount slews. We just care about how smooth it is when it's tracking. So it's something that I could definitely test more for future videos. Okay, to sum up, I'd say that if you're just learning about how spectroscopy works, or if you're brand new to it, the star analyzer and the RSpec are really ideal for that. And I think they'd also be great for showing off spectroscopy in an outreach context. Capturing and analyzing nighttime spectra with the SHG 700 seems a bit more advanced, but the solar part has been worked out incredibly well. The tutorials, the scripts, the software available make it very straightforward. So to my eye, while these are both products that can turn your telescope into a spectrograph, they serve a slightly different purpose. And hopefully this review has helped you understand what the differences are. I wanted to share a couple book recommendations if you're interested in spectra. The first is The Glass Universe by Davis Sobel. I used to work at the Harvard College Observatory, where the largest collection of astronomical glass plates is held, and I got to work with the original notebooks of the Harvard Astronomical Computers, which was a group of women who worked at Harvard around the turn of the century and were instrumental in early work on stellar spectra. And they would use these huge glass plate photographs of the night sky. Annie Jump Cannon especially was legendary for classifying stars, and the stellar classification system that we still use today was developed by Cannon and the Harvard computers. And The Glass Universe, this book, is a very readable nonfiction telling of the story of the Harvard computers, especially Wilhelmina Fleming, Annie Jump Cannon, and Henrietta Swan Leavitt, who were all contemporaries and all made very important contributions to the field of astronomy. Okay, the second book I recommend, which I just finished, is Spectroscopy, The Key to the Stars by Keith Robinson. It's not too long. And this one goes into the physics of understanding spectra, but it does it without going deep into the math, which I was very appreciative of. Even if even though I didn't really absorb necessarily everything in this book, I'm very glad to add it to my personal astro library as a good reference on the subject to return to. And speaking of libraries, I keep my library of my best finished astrophotos on my personal website at nicocarver.com. And that site was made with today's sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace is the all-in-one place to get your own website up and running without any coding knowledge. Squarespace makes that easy with their professional templates and their drag-and-drop design system called Squarespace Blueprint. I can quickly change the appearance of anything on my site through intuitive controls that update the design immediately. And I love that everything I need is built in and ready to go. Right away, I could start using the spam-free contact form, and if I ever needed to sell something on my website, Squarespace has you covered there with easy-to-use templates for selling services and products, and plenty of options for payment from PayPal to credit card to Afterpay. So if you need a website, check out squarespace.com/nebulaphotos for your free trial. And if you like it, then you can use code nebulaphotos at checkout for 10% off your first purchase of hosting or a domain. That's it for this one. Till next time, this has been Nico Carver, clear skies.